David Beatty, the first-year coach, longtime Texas high school coach, was at A&M with Kevin Sublin as the receivers coach before taking over. And the opening kick to KD Cannon will go through the end zone for a touchback. And the Bears will open at their 25-yard line. And Spencer Tillman, give me the three things we need to know when the Bears have the football.
Well, it ain't rocket science. Shock Linwood, you know, he's the guy that's got to provide the shock and awe. And he certainly will do it. Broke off a 79-yarder to open last week. And that'll going to allow them to remain balanced, Timmy, if he gets going early. And, of course, staying on a roll. This is a bigger picture situation for this Baylor Bears team. They've got a four-week stretch now where they'll be highly favored. They've got to continue to impress. And even though we're not in the old era of the polls and all that stuff, at least weighing heavily, this is a beauty contest for Baylor. No mistake about that.
Yeah, they're not going to take the foot off the jugular, that's for sure. Quick slant into Corey Coleman. He's ahead for 8 or 9 yards. They stay ahead of the chains. As you look at the numbers on Seth Russell, he has been magnificent. First in the FBS, touchdown passes, yardage incredible, breaking all kinds of records. Another one complete to Cannon, just shy of midfield, out to the 49-yard line.
Timmy, they're going to go pace and tempo. That's the style. That's what they do. And his efficiency, again, is augmented by so many tools around him. You see Cannon, he's one of the assets. He's got five of them that he can go with anytime.
15 yards on that reception. And here's Shock Linwood off the left side. This is an experienced offensive front. They return all five starters. Drango, Muir, Fuller, Broxton, and Colbert. Big-time guys. And really, Ben Goodman is the star of the defensive front. He's got a big challenge today. That pass, a timing route thrown incomplete for Corey Coleman. Providing coverage was Arnaz Ogletree, who's in for Brandon Stewart, out with a groin pull today.
Yeah. Ogletree doing great defensive work there with his back to it. Probably could have turned around to locate the ball. But again, that back shoulder pass is a very difficult for one, even for this accomplished offense to make, and Russell.
Third down and 6. And they go with a wheel route out to Linwood, and Shock may have made the marker. I believe he did at the 41-yard line. Ogletree got underneath him, but that last lunge netted him another first down. It's very rare that you get Baylor in a third and relatively long. That, for them, was a third and long. Linwood again takes it. Just off the guard and tackle spot on the left-hand side. And Chevy Graham, 36, the nickelbacker, makes the stop after a 9-yard gain. Look at that. The number of starts for Baylor's O-line versus Kansas defensive line. Going long for the end zone, incomplete. Coleman, the intended receiver. This is all about using the width and the length of the field, isn't it?
Yeah, Michael Glassick defending there from his deep safety position, trying to get an inside hand there. Just a nice little touch to let him know he's there defending. Ball just beyond the reach of the receiver. Tremendous job of defense, but even better ball of placement by Russell.
On third and a yard, Shock Linwood. No stretch play, then he cuts it back inside to about the 15-yard line. Marquise Roberts, number 5, had a pick 6 last week in the loss to Iowa State, making the tackle, the transfer from South Carolina, 17-yard gain. First and 10, quick look in, thrown behind the intended receiver. That was Davion Hall, 16, the sophomore from Texarkana, prepped at Liberty Ilo High School.
That ball on the back shoulder, again, that quick slant, it's really is a famine or feast type route with single coverage, Timmy. You place it where it's supposed to be, he hits his head on the goalpost for a touchdown.
Second and 10. And they go with Linwood again. Just shy of the 10 at the 11-yard line. Roberts comes over. An instinctual player, says his defensive coordinator, Clint Bowen. They really needed him, too. He's a fifth-year graduate transfer from South Carolina. Got injured, really, the last couple of years, but started a number of games for Steve Spurrier while there. Johnny Jefferson now in the backfield, number 5. They play fake it to him. That pass is caught. Coleman, touchdown.
Passes caught by number 1, Corey Coleman.
And just like that, the Bears exhibit all that we told you and then some when we opened our telecast.
Well, we told you a couple of plays ago, Michael Blatzik was defending from his deep safety position, but when you're playing off coverage down here, that's the last thing you can do. The best tactic is to play press coverage in the face of these athletic receivers. If they put you on an island with a cushion, that's double trouble, Tim.
11-yard touchdown strike. Chris Callahan with the extra point. On that drive, Russell was 4-for-7 for 41 yards. Linwood got 34 of it on 4 rushes. Run, fake action, and throw. That's the Baylor offense. The outside, and that combination devastating in the passing game. And Shaq Linwood also had 34 yards on that drive. That's the 20th touchdown pass of the year to lead the country.
Now, Russell there couldn't have come into a better situation. A junior and senior laden offensive front. No wonder why he's leading the nation in efficiency.
Shadler picks this one up off the ground. Ryan Shadler and gets out to the 26-yard line. A 12-yard return after a short kick. And let's get the three things that we need to know, Spencer, about Kansas when they've got the ball.
Well, because of the young quarterback scenario, you actually want to slow the game down, right? It reduces the ability of the big strike offense to deliver that knockout punch. And then you got to convert third downs. That's so important. The Jayhawks can't shorten the game if they can't control the football. And then, of course, got to have a career day for Kinner, their running back. He's their most dangerous weapon, Tim.
Keon by way of Navarro Junior College. He's the most dynamic player on this team. And he gets the carry up front. Taylor Cox actually gets that call just into the game to open rather than Kinner. Keon has been nursing some bruised thighs as well as a hamstring. So Cox actually comes out on the opening play to carry and remains in the game. And you saw the numbers on Ryan Willis. His first start as a true freshman native of this great state. That pass needs to be caught. If Kansas is to control the ball, Derek Neal, number 7, drops it. And that would have been near the necessary yardage for a first down. Against Iowa State last week, he came in for Cozart. This is the fourth option at the quarterback position. They have been depleted by injuries at the skill positions all season long. A very difficult start, even more so for David Beatty than he originally anticipated when taking the job.
Well, Phil Bennett's got enough pressure here. You can look at the top of the screen. That guy is sitting over the outside the end. He's not there because he just likes it.
Third down and 8. He's a pocket passer. That one's a little low. And a late marker comes in as Grant Campbell got to Barbell. Shaquem, 82, the senior, was on the receiving end of that intended pass.
Grant out of Bakersfield, California. He may have been a little bit on top of him from the angle that the side judge was viewing it.
Pass interference, number 5, defense. The ball will be placed at the spot of the foul. Automatic first down.
Alan Eck is our referee today.
Yeah, Kansas will take this any way they can get it. Willis again puts that ball low and away. And again, presence of mind of the receiver to choke it down just a little bit. Campbell drawing the foul.
Well, it's amazing to think that Kinner is not in this game to open. Obviously, he's a little too banged up to go. That out pattern is caught to Emmanuel Moore, number 20. Out to the 40-yard line. They are without today their leading receiver, Trey Parmalee, the team's leading receiver. A tough break for them to have issues with his leg. He can't go. Bobby Hartsog is out probably for a few weeks with an injury to his kneecap, a patella. Well, Kinner has come into the game on this particular play, second down and 5, so that's good news. They certainly need it. Towards the sidelines and incomplete. Good coverage there. Clyde McCauley was the intended receiver.
Howard was defending on that play, and I really like what Kansas is coming out doing now, relying on the one asset that young Ryan Willis has, and he's got a big gun. Everybody's been raving about it since he came on board, a 6'4", 205-pound freshman out of Overland Park, Kansas. He's an outstanding athlete, but we haven't seen him run the ball, probably won't see him run the ball, but we know he can throw it well.
Third down and 5. And a slide at midfield by the freshman Willis.
Willis took the shot last week and learned quickly how to get down. That's a nice slide right now. We're in the postseason for baseball. He must have watched a bit last night. Excellent job of sliding on that to protect himself and extend drives. One of our keys to the games that we talked about.
Taylor Cox back up into the game, replacing Kinner after the 10-yard pickup by Willis. On first down. Cox buried immediately. Coming through there, Jamal Palmer, 92, the senior from McKinney, Texas. This is a very stout defensive front.
Coming from his and the lineman, I tell you, Palmer really put it on there, just knifing in, working with some latitude to go either direction. Fantastic job by Palmer.
Second and 10. Plenty of pressure up front. They brought the house, Grant Campbell among them, and that's what Phil Bennett will do. He and Jamal Palmer, 92-5, sandwich Ryan Willis for the loss.
Well, you can see it coming off the edge on the outside. Number one, Palmer Company working that left side from his end position, putting pressure, throwing the ball where they've got more to defend than you can actually block. It's going to be a recurring theme for Phil Bennett in this defensive unit.
Third down and 7-10. Taylor Cox back into the backfield. Willis, nice. Back shoulder throw, and it's caught. That's McCauley inside the 40 at the 37-yard line.
Howard was defending on that play. Once again, you can see the nice soft coverage. Howard with the nice chuck, but it's the turnaround. He sees and identifies the ball, but an outstanding job and a bigger arm by the quarterback. That's an NFL caliber throw right there by Willis.
Jamal Booker was the receiver on that play. McCauley is the tight end, 83. Jamal Booker being used heavily early on here by Kansas. Lofting one. Close. Touchdown! Against the pressure of Steven Sams Jr. How about that for the freshman?
And the freshman got behind T.O. Wright on the coverage there, trying to do a fantastic job, but everybody's on an island. I don't care who you are, if you got a Jayhawk, the side of your helmet, you've got to be able to defend an open space. Tim, Kansas Jayhawk playing like David right now, not at a disadvantage, baby.
Bartolotta, who missed an extra point last week against Iowa State and a field goal try, his confidence may have been shaken. Let's see how he handles the extra point. Nothing is automatic. Right through the uprights to tie this game. So you're without your top receiver, your third leading receiver. Why not go to Mr. Sims? Freshman to freshman, a flyer from Houston, Texas, takes it from the guy from...
Here's what Willis is looking at. He's looking at that high safety look. There's nobody in the hole back here. See, no free safety means that he's got one-on-one coverage on the outside, Tim. That's where the route is going to happen. When you beat man coverage, no single safety, you're just counting numbers. And Willis, the young quarterback, he puts a sling in, a rock in that sling, and delivers a strike.
Talking to his offensive coordinator, Rob Likens, who was hired away from California, that magnificent offense that Jared Goff was running for Sunny Dykes. And this kickoff is coming down to KD Cannon. He'll bring it out from 5 yards back. He's in some trouble and decked at the 13-yard line. Let's get a Lowe's game break. Back to Los Angeles and Jenny Taft.
Tim, thanks. Number one, Ohio State once again coming out of the gate slowly against Maryland as Perry Hills finds DJ Moore wide open, 52-yard score. This is Maryland's first visit to Ohio Stadium. Good start as they're on the board early, 7-0 in the first quarter. Tim Spencer, back to you.
All right, Jenny, thank you. A lot of conversation about Randy Edsall during the week, whether he would survive after this game. So some emotion off of the field that may be impacting the play on the field this afternoon there. First and 10 for Baylor now, tied at 7. Shot Linwood. But on setback, they go 4 wide as usual. No tight end in this offense. Corey Coleman, again, it's just right there for the picking. They get first downs, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 yards. It's amazing how this offense, a marriage or combination of run game and incredible speed downfield, takes command of the chains. Linwood, he takes out 10 more yards beyond the 35 to the 36-yard line. Chevy Graham making the stop. They're going to actually say he got 9 rather than 10. So second and less than a yard.
Tim, and it's that combination of being able to pass and run that really makes them, in my opinion, the most dangerous team in the nation.
whistle. Well, he's resourceful back there, not known as maybe an RG3 type, but he does get ahead for 2 or 3 yards. Daniel Wise makes the stop. It is another first down.
And the asset that he has, again, is the ability to do both, because you have to deploy and defend. I don't care who you are defensively, the numbers is what you must respect initially.
Linwood. Look at that spin move, huh? Shock Linwood, he's got it all. He'll be ushered out of bounds near the 20-yard line. They're going to rule him out at the 22. Fish Smithson, number 9, the junior from Baltimore, taking him out.
Oh, spin, spin, spin. Ogletree whiffing at that one. It was a nice in-the-phone booth kind of move there by Shock Linwood, showing you some athleticism to go along with the speed and the ability to read.
40 yards on that carry. It pops free for Jefferson. Johnny Jefferson, the sophomore from Killeen, Texas. Had a great week of practice. They wanted to get him more time. Gladsick, 39, the safety, making the tackle for KU.
We're really getting a snapshot of how quickly this offense can score and move the ball down the field.
There it is, Coleman in the middle. Yeah, I think he may have gotten away with one there on this quick slant. Ogletree was covering, but he had a little help and a bump to go with it.
Well, you got to do something and defend. You got off coverage. Ogletree closes on it. Begin to. Yep. I'm surprised the umpire didn't call it. Maybe from his vantage point, the depth of field didn't allow him to see the connection and the contact.
Second and 10. That ball got on the deck. It fumbled. Russell got back on top of it at the 10-yard line. And keep an eye down here on number 80, Laquan McGowan. All 6'7", 410 pounds of him. Number 80. He is a load. Sometimes they'll line him up as a fullback, H-back situation, but as a tight end, he's nimble.
He's got his own zip code out there. He's a big boy.
There's Coleman, touchdown. Don't blink. Baylor is back in for 6. One thing about it, you don't have to maintain blocks for long in this offense, do you?
You really don't. And then you bring in a 410-pound tight end, and you're thinking you're definitely going to run to that side. Maybe they haven't thrown to him yet, but, you know, Art Briles has got a tremendous ability for innovation, Tim. When he brings that big guy in there, your instinct as a defender is to intuitively, instinctively try to overload that side and cover him to contend with his big body. But yet you go back and throw the ball the opposite direction. Brilliant.
Callahan's extra point. Makes it a 14-7 game.
Nice window.
Oh. And the quickness and how precise was the throw.
Sumlin, defensive beast right now, man. I'm telling you, A&M is going to make some noise on that defensive side of the ball with John Chavis calling the shots as defensive coordinator.
They lie in wait for Alabama next week. They've got an open date. That game will be at College Station. Ryan Shadler is back deep. And the kickoff by Evans. Great return by Shadler. They love this kid. Absolutely love him. He's another freshman from Heston, Kansas.
One of the things that Coach Beatty told us yesterday in all phases of the game and special teams, they've got to find one of those three and dominate it and be a factor together with great performance, protecting the ball, moving the chains, and great special teams. They got a chance to put another rock in that sling and slay the Giant.
Yeah, 43-yard return there by Shadler. Again, we mentioned Keon Kenner, the leading ground gainer for this team, over 341 yards coming in, bothered by some nagging injuries, and Taylor Cox is in there to start this series as well. Willis, the freshman quarterback, hands to Cox. He gets out beyond midfield to about the 49. Jamal Palmer makes the stop. You know, and talking with Phil Bennett, I've known him for 30 years. You know, he's an old A&M guy. Went on Curly Hallman's staff at LSU in the early 90s. He said, I never thought that I would be looking at my defense in quite the manner I do with the style of play Baylor employs. They take a lot of chances, even with the personnel that they have.
Yeah, he's accepted the notion that we have to redefine what constitutes good defense. So giving up yards necessarily is not always indicative of a bad defense. So he's adapting to the change.
On 2nd and 6. Cox, the 48-yard line. He's been around, and, you know, he was with our Dave Weinstadt at Pitt while he was the head coach and had the opportunity to join. He said, I got convinced by Art Briles that it was going to be different, and we were going to change the way the game is played. And he said he didn't lie to me. He told me exactly what he was going to do, and guess what? He's done it.
But that reality, Tim, has actually extended his career. Again, you said at 59, he's going to be around a long time because nobody's defending the run quite like this Baylor defense, and he's the captain of it. He's leading.
Third down and three. Willis's pass. Well, it was there. Taylor, the intended receiver, tight end, thrown just beyond him by a yard or two, and that will leave fourth down and three. But they're in a position where they could be in four down territory here.
Yeah, Ryan Stewart was actually lucky because he got beat on that play.
Yeah, they're going to kick it. Play field position here.
Well, that tells you a little something about they feel a little bit confident about where they are now.
Yeah.
So it's one thing to wish you were David, another thing to play like, because it's about aligning your core values of what you say you're going to be about. I mean, I think this is a good decision.
Yeah, Kahn will boot it away. High, short punt intended for Hawthorne. He's back there, and it will go out of bounds. Shanked that State on Fox. Joe Huebner, who quarterbacked a week ago, had a hip injury. Cody Cook had to come in for him, a wide receiver. He got injured. They think that Huebner will be able to go and start the game tonight in Manhattan for Kansas State. Shaq Linwood will get it ahead to the 26-yard line on first down for the Bears. Michael Glatzik, 39, the senior from Butler Community College, a former walk-on wide receiver, making the tackle. This littered with walk-ons in this defensive lineup for Kansas. That quick pass to Hawthorne is complete for a first down out to the 42-yard line. 18 yards on that pickup.
Well, Kansas can't get lax here. They've got to defend every receiver on the football field. They're going three wides now, but on that last four wide out look, actually a four wide package now. On that last look, Timmy, Kansas had a tough time identifying personnel.
Out to Linwood. Shot with a high hurdle at the 48-yard line. Looks to have hit the sticks right at the yardage marker to make another first down.
Look at that downfield block right there by the center of attention, Kyle Fuller, the center. We're going to keep an eye on him for you all afternoon.
Looking long, deep for Platt. Incomplete. Already eight plays of 10 yards plus, including a 40-yard touchdown run for Baylor.
And the one previous to the last play with Kyle Fuller downfield making a block. Again, people don't really appreciate, even in an up-tempo offense, how integral the center is. We know that it historically, no matter what you're running offensively, is important. But he's the guy that has to get the signal in because we've got an offside coming.
Yeah, this should be a free play. It's right there. And it's caught at the five by Coleman. Boy, he just absolutely schooled the defender, Smithson, in that sequence. I think he deked him a little bit on where the pass was really coming.
Number 10, defense. The penalty is declined. The play resulted in a first down.
Well, Smithson was in position, but again, really high-pointed him, did Colvin on that particular play and plucked it away from him. These are islands of excellence. Everybody's pressed in man coverage. You've got to win your individual battle. And number one is going to win his fair share of it.
He's already been in the end zone twice. There's the fade, another. Can you say three touchdown catches? They're going to say no. He was out of bounds.
It was still a little artwork, though, in getting released with the press coverage. And that's as beautiful as anything, Timmy. Watch the reach over just beyond the point when it happened. But going up and getting that ball and plucking it out of air to get past man coverage in such a constricted part of the field in the green zone, 5 yards in, is impressive by Coleman.
Johnny Jefferson, the play fake, and it's kept for the touchdown by Russell.
So that's what happens when they must respect your inside rush game. And again, the balance. Top 10 in both passing and rushing is this Baylor offense. And again, Russell doesn't expose himself to injury. Everybody's chasing that inside run game to shut it down, and he just waltzes in for the score.
Callahan for the extra point. Seven plays, 80 yards. Only a minute 14 off the clock. So you think And look at those numbers. I don't care who you're playing non-conference, and a lot's been made of their non-conference schedule, but well, this is as prolific an offense as I've seen.
The numbers don't lie. Timmy, Baylor led the FBS in total offense and scoring offense each of the last 2 years. And I'm telling you, they're on pace to trump what they did last year. They are that good.
And a mistake on the kick by Evans. The ball will come out to the 35-yard line after the flag. Well,
free kick out of bounds. Number 39, kicking team. The receiving team will take possession at the 35-yard line. First down, Kansas.
I'm a man for all seasons, so I took Spencer Tillman to Fog Allen Fieldhouse last night.
Hoop it up, baby.
Late night at the Fog here on campus, and guess what happened? Sophomore Jared Martin Castro won't have to eat just ramen noodles this semester. He won $10,000 after the director of basketball operations, Brennan Bouchard, hit a half-court shot, and yeah, Coach Self, his own checkbook, writing the $10,000 check for the extra. Congratulations to him.
He looked happy to do it. Bill Self's a great man. I go back to the days of Tulsa when he was there with the Golden Hurricanes. A long time ago, man. What a great man he is.
Made a run to the Elite Eight with that team before losing to North Carolina. Taylor Cox relates to the backfield. Tumble! And I believe Willis did get on top of it at the 37-yard line.
And that was Jamal Palmer sticking his nose in there and doing a job on the quarterback. You got to hang onto that rock in tight quarters. You know, Palmer 6'3", 240, but he's very, very active from McKinney, Texas. Tremendous asset on this front.
Keon Kenner has checked back into the game.
You know, Palmer along with Billings and, of course, Sean Oakman represent a trio of that four. Very mature defensive linemen who are very disruptive.
Willis. Down the sidelines, incomplete. Pass was intended for Sims Jr. Had the touchdown catch earlier, defended by Ryan Reed, number 9. Junior from Sherman, Texas.
Ryan actually had pretty good coverage on that play, but I like Kansas's idea of taking a shot downfield. They're not afraid to air it out. Number one, the big asset of their young quarterback is his arm. They're relying on it.
Third and 9. Trips receiver set to the bottom of your screen.
Darius receivers have got to win. Got to win the matchup, Tim.
Darius Crowley at the bottom of the screen. They go with the fade. The pass is intercepted at the sideline. And it's Xavier Howard, number 4. He just got rid of the receiver, and the pass came inside shoulder rather than outside shoulder. That's the first turnover of the game as they went bump and run right from the outset here.
Yeah, I think there was Eric Rivers on the outside against press coverage. He just got pushed out of bounds. You've got to stay engaged. You've got to be physical to fight, to get back inbounds, to make that kind of a play. Turnovers were one of the three things that Coach Beatty says they've got to do well along with the winning the turnover battle. It's about the special teams and, of course, limiting the penalties. That's one key area they could not afford to give up to.
He just dispensed with Jeremiah Booker.
Yeah, he did. Now, that's just being more physical.
What an incredible lineage of quarterbacks that Bryles has had. And, of course, his son, Kendall, an outstanding high school phenom himself, a quarterback, now the play caller for the Bears. Russell showing you how resourceful he can be. Not looking to run, but keep the play alive. And he does. Caught by Jay Lee. Coming back to the ball, which the Baylor receivers know all too well. And it's another first down after a 30-yard pickup.
And the tough thing about it from Kansas' standpoint, they actually played with pretty good integrity on that broken down play. But that's the advantage of having all this athleticism out here for Baylor. Somebody's going to get open. You can't hold the defense that long.
Linwood ahead for 3 to the 17. Jackie Deserve, number 54. And Ben Goodman Jr. also involved. Second down, and we'll call it 7 after a pickup of 3. Look at that. That's a first down on every play.
Incredible.
There was a little mix-up in the handoff that time as Corey Coleman, who will move a little bit like Oregon's Byron Marshall a few years ago when they moved Royce Freeman in to replace him. Marshall went from running back, 1,000-yard gainer to wide receiver. Coleman moved into the backfield that time. They lost some yardage, and it's third down and nine. This is as long a third down situation as Baylor will ever face. They go empty now.
Yeah, they got the inside slot receiver up top on the numbers, Timmy. Even though he's got press, he's the best opportunity to beat or the two wide guys because the safety's inside the hash.
Inside. There it is. Quick. But underneath, not enough for the first down to Lynx Hawthorne on the slant. Tevin Shaw, number 30. Nickelbacker making the stop. Junior from Piscataway, New Jersey.
Love that look versus a high safety. Again, he's inside the hash mark, but the post route took the safety that way, which meant if you complete that pass and beat the single coverage, there's no one in the middle of the field to prevent that from being a score.
Well, here's the good news if you're Kansas. They force a field goal, and they don't kick them that often. They really don't. Callahan will try. One for one this year. This one from 31 yards. Well, he's efficient, even if he doesn't get that many chances at field goal tries. Let's get back to Los Angeles, our Jenny Taft with this game break. Jenny.
Tim, thanks. Let's check in on the Red River rivalry. Number 10, Oklahoma and Texas. The Longhorns' Marcus Johnson down the sideline, 24 yards for the touchdown. Texas looking to put some life back into their season and have since added on another touchdown. It's 14-0 in the first. Tim Spencer, back to you.
It was amazing to think that that game that resonates throughout this area of the country and really all of college football, you're a part of it, is so overlooked, so in the shadow of the collegiate landscape this season, Spence.
Well, there are performances that are excellent that are going on all over the nation. And again, right here in this game, we're seeing one of those offensive examples. As prolific as Baylor has been in this first half, Timmy, they've averaged 38.5 points, 403 yards in the first half of the game so far this year. So they're under the mean numbers for their offensive performance over so far this year. So this is an outstanding job by Baylor, of course, but Kansas can hold their heads up because they're actually keeping below their average numbers for the season. You're talking about Kendall Browse earlier. Now, I think he's got a little bit more aggressive streak than his dad does.
He does. Have. Or Phillip Montgomery, who he replaced, now the head coach at Tulsa. We saw him a couple of weeks ago, ironically, in Norman against Oklahoma. They had over 600 yards of total offense that day. Ryan Shadler from his two. Stopped at the 20-yard line, an 18-yard return. Well, the top 10, and what's ahead today? What to keep an eye on? We already know Maryland is giving the Buckeyes all they want, and TCU and Kansas State coming later today. I love this matchup coming up later today between Utah and California, a game that I think is an irresistible force against an immovable object.
Yeah, Kyle Whittingham, you know, had some acrimony among his staff early in the year, and that can undo a team and its objectives quicker than anything. But boy, they've shaken that off in a hurry, and have implemented that up-tempo offense to go along with his strong defensive pedigree to put themselves in a great position.
Devontae Booker, one of the best running backs America knows the least about. Taylor Cox out to the 22-yard line. He gets about two. We'll call it second down and eight. Coming up, the charge led by Avion Edwards, number 20. College football on FS1 is presented by GEICO. Tim Brando, Spencer Tillman here at Memorial Stadium in Lawrence, Kansas. Devon Blanchard, 48, outside linebacker. Those are two positions they're replacing, the Mike and Al Nickelbacker positions, and he's really played well. They'll blitz him a lot, number 48. I think we have a timeout taken as the play clock was winding down.
Timeout, Kansas. Their first charge of the half.
Yeah, Phil Bennett showing them what we call a sugar look, kind of moving, isolating between man blitz coverage looks and zone, and it gave the young quarterback a bit of a quandary with respect to what he was going to do play-wise.
You know, they've got, you know, we talked about how many players returned to this defense and all the experience that they have, but they also lost Bryce Hager, who's now on the 53-man roster with the Rams, and Colin Brinst, who was another star for that defense, and they really replaced them beautifully in both Blanchard and the transfer graduate student, Grant Campbell. These guys have really made a difference since coming over. The flip side, of course, for Kansas, a lot of first-time players. a lot. And more than perhaps David Beatty bargained for. 44-year-old Garland, Texas native. Second down and eight. Willis. Well, there you go. Back shoulder again to Tyler Patrick. Little mix up on that route being run.
Yeah, now you're starting to see the pressure up front. Andrew Billings, Jamal Palmer putting a significant push on the quarterback. All of a sudden, Ryan Willis not able to get that ball off as cleanly, and it's off his mark as opposed to those open, deep routes he was able to successfully throw in the first quarter.
They really need to move the chains and keep the clock rolling a little here. More pressure. Willis looking to throw. He's got his man, and he goes back shoulder again. That's Derek Neal on the receiving end. Sophomore from Lincoln High in Dallas.
Well, Derek Neal did a great job of stopping and relocating that ball, and first of all, to make it possible, Ryan Willis escaping the pressure of that front for Baylor. Moves to extend the play, one of our keys of the game to stay alive.
That was a big first down.
Huge.
They needed to keep their defense off the field as we come to the end of the first quarter. The ball loose. I think it may have come loose late as he was hitting the deck. Baylor says they got it.
If it does, it's Trayvon Blanchard who came down off of that edge. And, boy, he came hard screaming off that left side.
Edwards comes away with the recovery. Avion Edwards and Blanchard, as you mentioned, made the connection. So just as Kansas was getting breathing room and perhaps an opportunity to keep the defense off the field, this occurs.
Well, you see 48 Blanchard in there, put his helmet coming from that outside wide alignment. Ball security, one of the keys, again, that we talked about, along with special teams and limiting the penalties. Kansas has got to do a better job of not giving this juggernaut Swiss Army knife offense of Baylor a short field. Just before the half. Wow, this is...
No, it's a quarter, but I mean, get your quarter, drift. It's easy because you look at the scoreboard and you say, well, I got 24. That's a lot for one half. No, wait a minute. That's more like a typical quarter for
Baylor. We are in Kansas.
That's a great hit by Blanchard. We were just talking about him. What a ball hawk he's been. And that's really the key for Phil Bennett's team is that how many points you give up is not as big a deal as getting the ball back to your prolific offenses, and they do that very well.
Well, this is part of an integrated approach to coaching these days. Again, I don't care. You are in a beauty pageant type era, Tim, where the offense and the defense will need to collaborate because to insulate themselves from what happened to them last year, being leapfrogged by Ohio State and missing that field of four, one of the ways you can do it is certainly, as Coach Browse looks on, is to have enough offensive firepower and getting the ball back. Your defense has a role to play in that in generating turnovers.
Hey, Art's success going back to his days in high school and then on to Houston. Left that for Kevin Sumlin. They kept that juggernaut going. Got a great tree of coaching success.
Shot Linwood and it breaks free. Wide open for him. Inside the 25 to the 24. Smithson with the saving tackle.
As we come to near the end of the first quarter, they will, after the first down, set the clock. And then it will continue to run. After the 20-yard gain, the Baylor Bears, number 3, and proving why early on here in Kansas. FS1's coverage continues of Big 12 football. And every 7 lead with Spencer Tillman, Tim Brando. I know that they're depleted with injuries and they're awfully young, but you still have to be impressed with everything that you've seen in this Baylor offense.
I'm impressed. Again, you talk about shock and odds. We talk about the top of the show. How about 111 yards for Shock Linwood? How about your quarterback? 170 yards in the first quarter. This is unbelievable offense. I mean, they got so many weapons and assets. We haven't seen the bulk of them. Coleman has been having the lion's share of offensive production so far.
They got others.
Yeah.
I mean, they really do. Linwood took it inside the 10. He's going to spin, and get in almost down to the 1-yard line. Fish Smithson saves the tackle, and our stat comparison is brought to you by the Lincoln Motor Company. And That tells you really all you need to know. Total yards, complete blowout. And Baylor about to go in for a 30 spot with Linwood here. I think they're going to say maybe he did not get hit. No signal as yet. He thought he had made it.
Yeah, he did. And that very mature offensive front, Drango, Muir, Fuller, Broxson, Pat Colbert. They're going to take pride in watching this one.
Third and goal. I think they may review this. Yeah, they need to. Yeah. I think Art Briles wanted it. His son, Kendall, you see there next to him. One of the best quarterbacks you'll ever see in high school was his son, Kendall.
Yeah.
I think this lunge netted him the touchdown. I really do.
Well, he ran into his own guy there. I mean, that part of it, that was McGowan.
Where the knee is and where the ball goes. Oh, wait a minute. Right hand is down. So it's a good no. I think he will be spotted shy of the end zone.
Here's a better look right here. Great job by the truck.
Right hand.
That hand is down.
Yep, hand is down. I did not see that hand go down. I thought he had just catapulted himself into the end zone with that last lunge.
Yeah, the right hand, it's the knee. I mean, yeah. the right hand was down, but that's for balance purposes.
It would be if your elbow.
It
would
absolutely
have to be your elbow.
That's
right. But I think the knee may have gone down prior to that, so I don't know that they're going to overturn this.
I don't think so because it's not clear from the angle we saw. If the right knee was down, clearly we saw the hand was down, but again, that's not going to constitute.
No, it's got to be the elbow.
Yep.
Listen, if you look at Baylor's stats, they're staggering, and if you watch them.
After further review, the ball carrier extended the ball beyond the goal line before he was down. Touchdown.
Oh, yeah. Well, I stand corrected. So it is a touchdown. But, you know, again, a lot's been made of that non-conference schedule, Spencer, but that will be eliminated from the debate if they can continue to progress from this point forward in this season.
Yeah, I think the element of recency, the narrative that they had to deal with last year and the acrimony that caused by being leapfrogged, despite how Ohio State ended the year, waxing the next strongest competition, Wisconsin, in their championship game.
133 yards now for Linwood and a touchdown to join with Coleman, who's been on the receiving end of three touchdowns. Baylor by 24.
Looks like we have some sort of sea monster in the water hazard here.
I believe that's a Kraken, Bruce.
It looks like he's going to go with the 9-iron. That may not be enough club.
Well, he's definitely going to lose a stroke on this hole.
If you're a golf commentator, you whisper. It's what you do. If you want to save 15% or more on car insurance, you switch to Geico. It's what you do.
This golf course is electric.
Just underway second quarter. Baylor's already hung 31 on Kansas with that magnificent offense of theirs. And look at this. Through the first four games, what do you notice there, Spence?
Well, you look at the conference, the Big 12 right there has got a big chunk of representation there. The late, great Georgia Tech coach Bobby Dodd didn't lie. He says, don't buck the trend. What they have in common? It's all about those spread air raid attacks, putting up big-time numbers. And you can see Baylor's up at the top, baby. Back-to-back years. Going for their third consecutive conference title. It's an impressive list of offense.
It was a different style that Nebraska had back in 95 when they were in the league.
Yep.
And were winning championships.
More of a focus on run. And again, it's not that Baylor's not focused on run. They're a balanced team. But because of the numbers of how they spread you out, they can be effective with six or five men in the box. They're just outstanding. They'll get those receivers a yard from the boundary, Tim.
Kick will go through the end zone, and let's go back to Los Angeles. Another game break on Ohio State and Maryland from Jenny Taft.
Tim, thanks. I got to keep you posted on the top team from the country. We've got Ezekiel Elliott from 2 yards out for the touchdown. Elliott coming off a career-high 274 yards at Indiana. The Buckeyes lead for the first time today, up 14-7 in the second quarter.
Ezekiel Elliott has been getting most of his against in short yardage situations. You know, stack the box with about eight or nine guys and then get to that second level and take off. He did it twice against Indiana.
Yeah, Kevin Wilson's though team played him well, though.
Really did. Deion Kenner is in the game, and he takes it off tackle. not much against that strong Baylor front. And Avion Edwards, number 20, who had that fumble recovery earlier, coming up to give some support. You mentioned Oakman at the outset of the game. Andrew Billings is another guy that's probably going to play on Sundays. Blackshear and Palmer are very active. Now, they take some chances in their perimeter, but their defensive front is as salty as any.
Yeah, I think Billings has been the biggest benefactor of course, Oakman drawing so much attention out there, being doubled and triple teamed. He's been making an inordinate amount of plays.
Second and nine. Willis running out of time. Decides to dump it. Incomplete. Intended for Darius Crowley, number 12, being blanketed by Ryan Reed.
Yeah, that was a secondary coverage force out of bounds there. The pressure, not much to work with. Ryan Willis had to throw that one away.
Emmanuel Moore checks into the game. He'll go into the slot up to the top of your screen. Again, this is an offense playing without its leading receiver, Trey Parmalee. One of its top go-to guys, Bobby Hartsog, as well. And a fourth option at quarterback, true freshman Ryan Willis, starting his first game from Bishop Miege High School in Overland Park, Kansas. That slant is incomplete. Fans wanted interference on Reed. Steven Sims Jr., the intended receiver, the timing looked pretty good.
Yeah, Ryan Reed played this technique exceptionally well because, number one, he knew he was in man coverage, press. He was playing an inside shade technique that allowed him to get just a little slight jump and a hand inside on that ball. It's a tremendous job of defending by Reed.
Ruben Guzman will punt it away. Number 45, and Lynx Hawthorne is wading back deep at his 34-yard line. He gathers it in. A lot of room. Needs one block. Got it, but when he cut back, he was tackled by Guzman, who actually kicked the ball away. So a saving tackle by the punter. Shock Linwood has been as advertised. Touchdown runs at 40 and 36 yards on the day. Family.
Beautiful shot.
Yeah. Sparse crowd on hand. We should mention that they actually have a fall break for the student body. So they're actually not in class, albeit historically Kansas has been, as well noted, a basketball institution when it comes to athletics. They had a packed house last night at Fog Allen. Seth Russell slides down at the 27-yard line.
I'll tell you what, the offense for Baylor, really guessing right more often than not. Kansas had a port side charge on that, a left directional charge by the entire left side of that line, and Russell just pulled it down and ran, slid for safe gain.
Johnny Jefferson is now checked into the game at running back, and he'll carry it. And good defensive work that time in support from the corner, number 25, Marnez Ogletree, out of Lawrenceville, Georgia, by way of Fullerton College.
Yeah, Ogletree really came up and forced on that play. If you want to find out if a guy's head is in the game, literally still, look at how well he fills and forces at that corner position. Ogletree, nice job of physical play.
Third and six, Russell. That pass was incomplete, intended for Katie Cannon. Good defensive work that time by the Kansas secondary.
Tevin Shaw was back there in the middle playing that nickel back, and he's coming from that inside position doing a tremendous job. You can see he's almost like a banjo coverage, one inside and out, doubling up on the Baylor receiver.
And going for it on fourth and six. You know, sometimes in situations like this, that can anger your opponent.
Yeah, you got to run forced on the outside. They can run this ball to the right really easily.
Now they go left, and they got the first down. Good call. Johnny Jefferson takes it in there for a first down at the 17-yard line, and it's Shaw making the stop.
Tim, that ball wind up going to the middle, but it was the few numbers on the right side that allowed that play to come back underneath. Baylor just counting them up and running where they're not on defense.
Yeah, and again, formation does so much of that. And we've got an injured Jayhawk. That's Fletcher, number 90, senior from Fort Lauderdale, Florida. Well, they have just been so depleted by injuries, they can ill afford to lose anyone at any spot at this stage. He's That left arm.
Yeah, he's got to look like he's got to never want to speculate, but when they're hanging that arm like that, usually it's a stinger of some sort.
Kapil Fletcher. I mean, Ben Goodman must feel all alone up there in terms of being a veteran. So many other young guys out there next to him. Jefferson, the setback on first down. Play fake over the middle. McGowan! Oh, 400 pounds!
Jake Lynn.
Take that fridge! 18-yard reception.
Well, Skyler Miles had a shot at him, but you know what? The big guy just gave him the old Jake leg, Tim. And stepped right over him.
All right, now I know America needs to know what you mean by that. Yeah. So go ahead with an old axiom I know from your playing days.
Yeah, it's about when you get a guy in your gun sights and you're ready to tackle him and he gives you the fake, and then you go for it and then he makes you miss. It's just like a little magic action. He dips on you when you thought you should have got him. It's the old Jake leg, Timmy.
Oh.
It's a dance move.
Gotcha.
You
gotcha.
Know about that.
Yeah, well, they don't call me toe-tapping Timmy
yes,
for nothing. Callahan with the extra point. I just felt America needed to know what you meant. McGowan, the senior. They say 30% body fat. He's like any other offensive lineman. He just happens to be 6'7 and 410. We'll be right back.
Good as there is in the big leagues.
The Rangers are in a great spot.
This is where it gets fun.
The slide, he's safe! The diving catch. Out of here! What a play! Absolutely crushed! Oh, another!
Just outstanding throughout, leading it 38-7. Evans will kick it away, and Ryan Chandler, number 33, back deep for the Kansas Jayhawks. Big McGowan on the receiving end of the last touchdown pass. Shadley will take a knee in the end zone after the muff. And it'll be first and 10.
Tim, here's an ominous thought. If you're sitting here looking at what we call a bob block, McGowan sitting in there, and he's going to kind of give you a lead draw look, but number 28 is the guy, Arnox, has got to stop him. How would you like to do that? So he rips and goes to the opposite direction. That's exactly where McGowan wants him to go. And then they put it in motion, and then watch him see him finish right over the top. The drop at 39 doesn't have a shot. That's Michael Gladsick. He doesn't want any part of it. Then the old Jake leg by the big fella. All 410 pounds of
him. He's nimble. He really is.
You know, he's a call that the Bob Block, back on backer. I think we've got to rename that the Beast Block.
Keon Kidder is in the backfield, and there's a quick out to Darius Crowley, and he gets ahead for maybe three. Ryan Reed with the stop, second down and 7 coming up.
That's the beautiful thing about Baylor's offense. They've got so many weapons, they can be so creative. When that guy gets on the field, you can't ignore him. Kansas has got to counter with some creativity of their own.
It's time again for them to give their defense a break and have a nice long drive here with 11 and counting in the second quarter.
They got a numbers advantage to the field. Let's see if they can exploit it. Yes, they do.
Kenner bouncing it outside. Good defensive work by Chance Waz, the free safety. Sophomore from Pflugerville, just outside the Austin area. Got his first career start against Rice and had 8 tackles. You can see Kenner's not himself. Taylor Cox checks back in.
Yeah, he had a couple hundred-yard games, one against Rutgers, and he followed up with another performance. He's been shut down because of that hamstring since then. And teams, of course, have been doubling up and in the box and putting 8 and 9 men front, so he's had to contend with.
Third and 3. There's the out pattern caught by Neal. That's a first down at the 36-yard line.
Nice pitch and catch there. Neal found a way to get open against that man coverage scheme. And again, at some point in time, somebody's going to be open, but you got to be able to hit him while that window's still open.
Kansas is 4 for 7 on third downs.
Well, that's one way to keep the ball in your hands and ultimately keep it out of a prolific offense's hand. Just move the chains.
Yeah, the turnovers have really beset them. You get behind in that category against a team with Baylor's efficiency and you're in trouble. And that's what's happened here in the first half. Willis will take it himself And there are markers behind him back at the 32-yard line. Orion Stewart, 28, ushered him out, but we'll check the flag thrown back at the 31-yard line.
Yeah, Brian Nance and company really put pressure on the young quarterback.
Holding, number 79, offense, 10-yard penalty, 3 points, first down.
Jordan Shelley-Smith, 79, out of Riker Catholic in Waco, Texas, playing against hometown team today. They'll back them up to the 26-yard line. Taylor Cox remains in the backfield. Tyler Patrick, number four at the bottom of your screen. They go trips to that side. Nothing doing for Taylor Cox. That shows you the quickness up front of Billings.
Yep. You know, you saw a 300-pound lineman just move so quickly on an inside technique there to thwart that opportunity for a run on that one. Billings was active, made that first step. He is so quick off the ball, Tim. You saw some of that speed on that last play.
Second and 22. See the total yards almost 3-1 at this stage in favor of Baylor. Kansas had a quality drive to tie the game at 7. And then they've committed a couple of turnovers, a fumble and a pass interception, giving up 14 more points that way. And then Baylor just being Baylor is quite enough, thank you. Taylor Cox forges ahead to about the 28-yard line, again in the arms of Andrew Billings.
Yeah, Billings and Blackshear and that whole group up front not ceding any territory whatsoever to this Jayhawk offense. And Cox just shut down in the middle of that defense. Billings is just so active, man. In that particular case, he stood his ground big time.
Third and 19.
Both offense and defense countering one another. Willis getting the play from the sideline, and ultimately Baylor's adjusting as well, real time. Just a three-man rush, though.
Ryan Willis steps up in the pocket. Cut down at the 31-yard line with great closing speed, Draymond Blanchard, number 48.
Yeah, Grant Campbell came with some pressure to force him. It ended up being a four-man rush, but nice little nifty move by Ryan Willis of moving outside. Not enough yards to move the chains, clearly, but again, nice job of dissecting what defensively Phil Bennett and this defense trying to do to him.
Leans Hawthorne, drops back deep. Ruben Guzman will punt it away, the senior from Fontana, California. Well, a lot of Royals fans, as you might expect, here in the Lawrence, Kansas area. And the ALDS does return to FS1 tomorrow with Game 3 between the Blue Jays and Rangers, as Toronto must win to stay alive in the series, while Texas heads home with a chance to complete the sweep. Coverage begins at 7:30 Eastern only on FS1.
Royals fans got a treat yesterday, huh?
Came from behind.
Came from behind to get a win against the Astros. They needed that.
They sure did.
As they head into Game 3.
That's a pretty salty starter that the Astros will counter with in Game 3. That was only a 23-yard boot, so poor special teams play has really hurt David Beatty's team. Quick wide receiver hitch out to KD Cannon. Inside the 45 to the 43-yard line. Ushered out by Ogletree again.
At some point, though, Kansas is going to have to change their coverage just a little bit. They're playing a little bit off coverage, giving about a 6 to 7 yard cushion on these talented Baylor receivers. If they're going to affect play, they've got to trust the safeties to help out in the interior.
Linwood, stop and go. Look at him. Keep the play alive. You talk about after contact, he got hit 3 different times there. Managed to keep his balance. Maisie Bates, 24, the last to hit him.
Yeah, and Skyler Miles and company were running and chasing on that particular play, but they couldn't get to him. He came down from that safety position.
Did get the first down from the 41. Russell's over the middle. And it's KD Cannon again to the 23-yard line.
Got a hurt player down, Tim.
Yep, another Jayhawk back at the 45-yard line. Looks like Desir, 54, might be down. 18-yard pickup.
Nice execution on the play, though, as the injured Jayhawk is down. And
So many new faces, Spencer, when you think about it. We talked to Clint Bowen, who is not only the assistant head coach, but also defensive coordinator. They're having to be as aggressive as possible.
As we look at that soft coverage we were talking about, again, look how far the safety's off of Cannon there. And then just a fine job of throwing the ball to the open man. And this is pitch and catch at this point.
I wanted to mention that Bowen was the interim head coach when we were last here, our crew. Brady Quinn was alongside with me that day when, on senior day, Bowen's team almost pulled an incredible upset of Gary Patterson's TCU Horned Frogs. Bowen could not get a victory when he took over for Charlie Weiss, but he really impressed a number of people. And his relationship with Beatty goes way back to being on the staff with Mark Mangino as head coach here a couple of times before Beatty left for Texas A&M. And, you know, those two guys vacation together. Their families go to Destin. Mm-hmm. There's Clint.
I like the continuity, you know, talking about what Clinton is all about. That 4-2-5 defense that he runs really is indicative of, despite his pedigree, him understanding how to defend these spread attacks today. You've got to get that nickel guy in there and not worry about the notion of I run a 3-4 or 4-3 and all that stuff. No, the game has changed, and to be able to deploy those young active guys are really important.
First and 10, pass is complete to Cannon again. He's been used primarily in this series, taken out of bounds at the 18-yard line. I really admire the fact that both Bowen and Beatty understand one another. They were probably the two highest candidates for the athletic director for the head coaching position, and each of them would have hired the other had they been named.
Kevin Sumlin.
Johnny Jefferson will take it. Inside the 10 to the 9-yard line. Well, you mentioned Sumlin. Yep. He was...
When he got the job at A&M, the first thing he did was call Beatty and said, hey, look, are you coming? It's all about trust, Timmy, and right. It's a small community. Everybody knows that. So when you're with someone you're comfortable with, they get a job, it's their job to kind of reach out to you and see if you want to stay with the family.
First and goal from the 9. Jefferson hauls it down to the 5-yard line. Chevy Graham, 36, making the stop out of Uniondale, another one of those walk-ons. He was a walk-on running back when he first arrived. Grew up not far from the old Nassau Coliseum in Uniondale. Looking for the corner. Jay Lee was the intended receiver, incomplete.
Let's see if we get an appearance from the big guy again on this as they get down in the green zone area. 5 yards inside. It's about power football for Baylor. They can do whatever they want to do. They're just that gifted and talented. There's McGowan there.
They look to KD Cannon, but they're going to give it to Jefferson, and it's wide open, touchdown. All about angles.
Yep, zone read.
Believe most people thought they could get to 50 by halftime, and they are now at 44 looking for an extra point.
And Timmy, they just put so much stress on you, the zone read there. The end crashes down. You pull the ball out or give it to the back, as the case may be. The read there, call for him to stick it in his stomach and leave it. That's just a tremendous job of executing. And Baylor, once again, doing what they do best, keeping you on your heels until they finish you off.
Chris Callahan for the extra point. The Bears have 3 passing touchdowns, 3 on the ground, and lead it by plenty.
It's not about hunger,
it's a team effort.
He's back in our
stead.
A
master of many, failure of few.
That's right.
Ryan Shadler is back deep. Awaiting the kickoff. College football Saturday is just getting underway. And there are a lot of storylines, particularly in Salt Lake City, Utah, where now the guys in the Mountain Time Zone are finally getting some attention. Plus, Northwestern looking to stay undefeated at the Big House against Michigan.
Well, we can't really call them a fly, but they're pretty impressive, man.
That's a huge game coming up in contrasting styles. Goff, by the way, has just been incredible. And Rob Likens, the offensive coordinator for Kansas, coached him a season ago, left him to become the offensive coordinator here. And Trevon Boykin and number 2 TCU in mini Manhattan. Gus Johnson, Joel Klatt, Molly McGrath will have that one for you tonight. First down 10, 5 and change remaining here in Lawrence in the opening half. And that pass is caught by Emmanuel Moore out to the 35. You've got to play and coach from down to down and not worry about the scoreboard at this stage.
It's about operating in a vacuum. We talked about Coach Beatty's attitude and approach. It's not so much becoming consumed with the outcome, winning and losing. It's about improvement on each particular play. These Kansas Jayhawks have to become islands of excellence, Tim. It's not being selfish, although the millennial cohort has perfected that art. It's about understanding what you've got to do to get better from play to play.
Second and 2. They go power with Cox. And that was a strong run, wasn't it? With good blocking up front, Grant Campbell makes the stop, but not before a first down was picked up at the 40-yard line.
Yeah, if you want to define yourself as an offense, Cox doing a nice job of just working on the lead draw, sifting through there to find some extra yardage. Again, at some point, Baylor, if they continue to have success, Kansas does, they will have to respond to that inside run game. And then maybe an opportunity or two versus man coverage will open up on the perimeter. Showing power formation again, Kansas.
Nice. Good cut. But an even better defensive maneuver there by Orion Stewart, 28, to make that shoelace tackle. It looked like there was some room beyond Stewart, but he was just too quick. Only a gain of 2.
Stewart did make a tremendous open field effort there. And again, you got to be more patient as a runner. You remember the old Edgerrin James used to talk about slow, too fast through. On that type of draw action, backs, Cox and company have got to be more patient to allow that to open and then make a move.
Second and 8. Play fake. Bootleg action, and this pass is knocked away. Great defensive work that time by Taylor Young, the outside backer who might be, at least according to Phil Bennett, number 1, the sophomore from DeSoto, Texas, the overall best player on this defensive football team, and only Louisiana Monroe offered him an opportunity at the FBS level. Well, this kid has really come on strong.
He really is talented. You know, he was the newcomer of the year in the conference last year in the Big 12. He's got tremendous range. He can run and chase with the best of them. I like his size, too, as well.
5'10", 225, ball's on the ground. Willis tries to ad-lib, and he loses it. Picked up, taken out of the air. Xavier Howard, touchdown. Bounced on the ground a second time after Willis had recovered it. And an easy win for number 4, the junior from Houston, Texas. And a lesson being taught right there by David Beatty.
Just about protecting the ball. Again, once you have an opportunity to see that you've got pressure, go ahead and take the loss. Don't try to do anything extra with it. The X-Man doing a great job of shutting it down and taking it in the house for the score.
Bo Blackshear, number 95, was the one that stripped him after he had recovered the first muff. Ryan Willis.
The poise is what you're looking for from your signal caller in those situations. The context matters. You're down. They've got their ears pinned back on the defensive side. You've got 4 and 5, 6 mans rushing. Got to protect the football.
Those that keep up with such things will notice that already it's a 45-point deficit for Kansas.
What if there was a bank that didn't just ask members to save, but also help them to save? That allowed families to keep more of their money, letting them use any ATM nationwide for free. And because every dollar matters, didn't nickel and dime its members with monthly fees, saving them more than $345 million in 1 year. That would be a different kind of bank. That would be USAA Bank. Go online to find out more about our free USAA secure checking account today.
52-7, Baylor with the lead, 3:45 remaining here in the opening half as we kick off our coverage of college football on the Fox family of networks today.
Deep for Kansas, number 33, Ryan Shadler.
Ryan Shadler is back deep awaiting the kick from Evans, who's been getting a workout here in the opening half.
Yeah.
Shadler really battling the sun there, could not find it, and he takes the knee. Well, Fox Sports Supports is proud to team up with the Boys and Girls Clubs of America, supporting their mission in helping young people to reach their full potential through programs that promote character and leadership, education, healthy lifestyles, and more. For more information, visit foxsportssupports.com.
That was a Maybe Center in Tulsa, Oklahoma, where I cut my teeth in football. The Boys and Girls Club, I had my membership card, dog-eared from heavy use after school. And, boy, along with a lot of my friends, we, in our formidable years, grew up at the Boys and Girls Club, a second home for us.
First and 10 from the 25-yard line now for the Jayhawks, and it's Taylor Cox again.
Yeah, that didn't look like it was special, but Cox did what we talked about earlier, just a nice job of running away from those white jerseys and being patient. Just a small, short game, but what it does, it speaks to his ability to read and react and do exactly what he needs to do, improve from cycle to cycle as a runner.
We should mention that Baylor is going to its backups. Raquan Davis was in for Campbell there, the middle linebacker, to make the stop. You know, the foot on the pedal will never stop, but they are a really balanced and deeper defense, so they are going with some backups in there at this stage as Taylor Cox carries again off the right-hand side behind Banks and Hughes. Hughes is a tackle that they think very highly of, has an opportunity to maybe become an all-conference performer in the future.
Yeah, you were talking about Raquan Davis and all those others out of Rockwall, Texas. All of them, you know, Edwards and company on that back end and, of course, in that linebacker core are getting tremendous experience on an already senior-laden team. So that gives momentum on the defensive side for Phil Bennett to continue to be strong as they move this program forward. And that you're talking dynasty-type stuff, which doesn't happen very much at this level, Tim. This program under Art Briles is set up for a long term of success.
Third down and four. Willis, pressure coming off the edge. He's looking long again for Booker. He was very involved early offensively, Jeremiah was today, and without either Parmalee or Hartsog, they've had to turn to him. Xavier Howard was back there covering.
Well, tough job, Booker there, and ball just beyond his outstretched hands. It's about concentration, but even the most focused guy probably misses that one because the ball was a little bit long, but tremendous effort.
Khan will punt it away. They really struggled in this area of the game today, and a fair catch called for by Huffle.
Touched it.
And the Jayhawks may have gotten a break. It is on the deck, and they believe they've got it. Cameron Rosser, number 59, a reserve linebacker, comes out of there with it.
Lynx Hawthorne made a mistake. He waves this ball off. Again, he's got bodies. He sees him. He kind of lets the ball hit him. And when that ball touches the ground, it could go anywhere, Timmy. You got to be cognizant of that and call Peter, get out of the way, because that's not a golf ball. Thing going to drop and just drop dead.
I think he anticipated that Spencer was going to interfere with him, and then he got away. DeAndre Mann, by the way, is in the backfield as they set up shop now after the turnover at the 32-yard line. It's almost as if he got distracted by what he thought was an oncoming defender that might interfere with his opportunity to catch the ball.
He has exclusive right to that ball, and if he's not going to catch it, he has to make sure his teammates and himself get away from it.
Willis throws that out pattern into some traffic, and it's caught. Bardell, 82, makes the stop of the catch, and it's ahead for about 5 yards on the play. So second down, we'll call it second and six after a four-yard gain.
Trying to go tempo here, but I love what Trayvon Blanchard did a great job of closing on that play and disrupting the opportunity. Kansas trying to seize on the turnover.
Willis again, that out pattern is complete, this time inside the 25 to the 23. Tyler Patrick, number four, as they stretch the width of the Baylor defense on the last two plays. Teon Wright, number three, making the tackle, third and one.
Yeah, Wright on an island out there on the short side of the field, forced to cover man. And again, Kansas is going tempo on you, showing power formation now on the run.
Nice. Cox gets it down to the 22-yard line. Taylor Young making the stop.
Yeah, they're going to go pass here. And again, they're just short here, Tim, but don't be mistaken. Now, the pedigree, just because they've got injury situations at the quarterback, does not mean they won't try to pass the ball in this situation.
Well, it's fourth and inches, but they're going to go shotgun. And
Timmy, I'm listening pass all the way here.
Yeah.
And that means they won't run it, but it's going to be dependent upon, look at this reduction up top, outside here, what Baylor is doing.
There is Cox. I think with the second bounce, he may be close. Taylor Young. Well, I don't think he got it. I don't think he got it. I think he got a right foot spot and he needed a left foot spot.
See, it was the reduction up top where you don't run it. I mean, listen, the defense will dictate where you go.
Yeah.
When you've got leverage on the outside and a reduction, a big in, you don't want to run in the teeth of that. I mean, it's just simple math is what it is. You count them up and you run away from the majority of them.
When the chains are coming from the top, you're looking for a left foot spot, and he got a right one, and
he's going to be short.
He's going to be short. Good effort, really solid effort, but not enough. And I don't think it's really that close.
That was Taylor Young came in there and really shut that thing down, man.
Yeah, almost a full yard. So the Baylor defense stiffens after what was a tremendous break that Kansas could not take advantage of. Well, coming up on the State Farm Halftime, Kevin Burkhardt, we mentioned how busy he's been back in our Los Angeles studios with baseball, the NFL, of course, his work on Sundays. Now in our college football studios for Rob Stone today, Dave Wannstedt and Matt Leinart will join him. And some big news in that Red River rivalry to go along with what Maryland and Ohio State have cooking in the Big Ten. Baylor's most points in a half a year.
Wow.
2 years ago, 56 against West Virginia. As you see, Coleman being ushered out at the 27-yard line. Tevin Shaw with the honors. So Baylor very close to the 56 number that they hung against West Virginia 2 years ago. Of course, Mountaineers got some measure of revenge a season back. Jefferson is the lone setback. Coleman. Nice crossing pattern out to the 45-yard line. 33 seconds left, and the clock stops after the first down. Klatsik and Smithson collaborate on the stop.
Nobody scores faster. Coleman found a nice window in that moving zone coverage of Kansas.
Russell throws. Almost picked off. You're right. The pass was released late that time. Smithson had a chance at the interception. That was number 9 on number 9, KD Cannon, the intended receiver.
Yeah, Seth Russell was a little bit late on that read there. And again, Cannon had a shot, but, you know, because of the ball being late, that safety came high out of that hole and broke it up. Nice job defense.
Second and 10. Flags fly. Looks like we've got a false start.
False start, number 73, offense, 5-yard penalty, second down.
Blake Muir, the senior out of New South Wales.
You know, Tim, sometimes people get upset that Baylor's doing what they're doing up here, now 52-7, but this is who they are. They're averaging almost a point a play, taking back the old Fritz Chrysler days, a point a minute man, right?
Yeah.
A Michigan man. They're trumping that, baby.
Swing it out to Johnny Jefferson. Back to the original line of scrimmage at the 46-yard line. Joe Dineen, Jr., number 29. Sophomore from Free State. Local youngster here in Lawrence, Kansas. Third down and 11 coming up. Russell. He just ran right into that sack as Daniel Wise was in the right place. It's not often he has to move that far back. You know, not many 3 or 5-step drops. It's basically a read and a throw for him. As we come to the end of the first half, the Bears leading it by a score of 52-7. Right now, let's send you to Kevin Burkhardt, standing by in our Los Angeles. But as Coach Wannstedt said at halftime with the guys in the studio, this is an impressive defensive football team to go along with an offense that with Seth Russell is 18 of 27, 246, three touchdowns passing, another one rushing.
Yes, the explosive plays that really set this team off offensively. Five different players with 18 yards or more. And as we define explosive plays, it's 10 yards, but we could go deeper than that, guys. Let me tell you, if you pick your poison, Hartthorn here, Corey Coleman is going to follow that up with a nice adjustment on this ball and just steals that ball away. And then KD Cannon, lead first, and then KD Cannon will follow with a tremendous effort as well. And then the big guy on the back end of this play, McGowan, does a tremendous job of moving with the J play again for the score. 18 explosive plays so far for Seth Russell and this Baylor Bear offense. Nowhere to run, nowhere to hide.
Explosive meaning better than 10 plus yards on a given down. And of course, McGowan, shoulder pads not always necessary, I suspect, when you're that stout. Taking it easy.
It's almost unfair that we use 10 yards with this particular team right here, and nothing's fair with that big guy. But with Russell doing a tremendous job on those explosive plays, Tim, I think we need to move that number up to around 20 or so. That's pitch and catch. Everybody's giving them 10-yard cushions. It's just sitting it down, and that's like stealing, man.
Spencer Evans boots it away. Shadler again is back deep, and we'll watch it sail through the end zone. The Jayhawks, as we said, prior to the game, knew what they had to do. They probably wanted to slow down their own pace. This is a team that, with Rob Likens, their offensive coordinator, formerly the passing game coordinator with Cal and Sonny Dykes, was at Louisiana Tech. He clearly wants to play tempo as he did at Cal and as he did with Louisiana Tech. But in this game against this team, you probably want to move the chains and keep that prolific offense off the field. 9 of 19, 107 in the first half for Willis with a pick.
Tempo works as long as you're not turning the ball over. When you start making mistakes, you got to simplify.
See a lot of the Baylor Bears, including McGowan, without pads on, so they'll go deep into their depth chart in the second half. Tyler Patrick on the receiving end of that pass in front of Trayvon Blanchard, number 48.
Well, Rob Likens told us that was part of his strategy coming in to necessarily slow things down because of the depleted wide receiver core and the inexperienced quarterback.
You see Drango's also, all the guys that are not going to play have their shoulder pads off. So much of that starting lineup for Baylor offensively will sit the second half. We can close the books on them. Cox, good stiff on there. And he's ahead to the 39-yard line. That's a first down. 9-yard pickup.
Gail Sayers will be proud of this one. Look at Cox use that left hand, the stiff arm right there. A tremendous job of staying balanced and vertical, because what you want to do when you see a guy closing in on you like that, Timmy, is to put that hand out there but also push him away and continue unimpeded to the destination of where you're headed. That's a tremendous job by Cox on that run.
Well, they tried to use as much of the play clock as they could.
Now Larry Hughes is going to get caught there for movement. He's trying to reach down.
73.
Yeah.
Hughes. Those false starts, can't afford them against a team like Baylor. And when you're trying to win just a down, that really gets in the way.
And I tell you what's going through an offensive line's mind. He knows he has to reach block. Okay, he has to get down against a guy who's reduced because the play is coming his way. But you got to be able to hold your water. Otherwise, you never get a chance to execute.
First down and 15. Nice. And that out pattern was a dangerous throw, but it was caught by Neal. Only picked up a yard on the play. Covered well by Taylor Young.
Love the design of that play, though, because my eyes were focused on the broad width of the field, but that play action really had me locked in on run, too. That was a well-designed play.
Second and 14. Crowley is in the slot to the bottom of the screen.
Back.
Willis, nailed. Pressure coming from Sean Oakman, averaging just under two sacks per game. That's 13th in the nation, and really off to a little bit of a slow start because of the double teams he's faced.
Sometimes you don't think that that back swinging out of the backfield is an option for you, but Willis has got to do a good job of understanding, first of all, from a pre-snap read that you're into the boundary, the short side of the field, two men are covering, no one except the inside linebacker is able to cover your back. That's a completion for at least a short game.
That was his 60th career sack, a school record. For Oakland, Cox taking that pass and getting it back to almost the original line of scrimmage.
Really impressed with Cox's physical play, man. This is going to be a roughing the passer penalty, but again, roughing the tackler was Cox's charge in that play.
Personal foul, roughing the passer. Number two, defense. 15-yard penalty enforced from the end of the run. First down.
Yeah, he looks to be shaking the cobwebs, does Cox, too, as he leaves. There's the penalty.
Yeah, he went high, too, and again, Palmer was pushing, but that's not where it came from. And
Oakland got it.
Clearly Oakland with the infraction there, coming back for a senior season to have a shot at winning it all. And one of the things Oakland's going to have to do, Tim, is be consistent in his play and not make those kind of mistakes. Otherwise, it's going to get frustrating for him.
From the 47 of Baylor, DeAndre Mann trying to cut it back, nailed after just a pickup of a yard. Chance Waz, number 18, the first to make contact with it. That may be one of the great conversation pieces about this Baylor team moving forward. And I mentioned that Dave Wannstedt loves what he sees from a defensive standpoint, even in today's game against a Kansas team that doesn't have all of its weaponry. They have not been challenged in a game, though, and that may be their biggest liability as DeAndre Mann takes it down to the 36-yard line, very close to another first down.
Yeah, DeAndre Mann did a nice job of moving with the defense as that ball was coming this direction. You're going to see him kind of flow away from all the traffic that's coming underneath. We talked about the formidable front that Baylor has. But you know what? When you're able to slide protected and move away from the flow of that, you can get a 2, 3, 4, 5 yard extra yards when you design it and read properly as he did on that play.
First down. Really using as much of that play clock as possible, and late they decide to take a timeout. Timeout here in Lawrence. 52-7, Baylor with the lead.
Woke up late, freaked, then remembered McD's all-day beef fast.
With our opening series out to a quality start. They've moved the ball into Baylor territory. They have gone, and a number of starters still from a defensive standpoint that are on the field, including Taylor Young, Grant Campbell, and others. Oakman is sitting down now. DeAndre Mann is the lone setback on first and 10. Room for Mann. In fact, tackled behind the line of scrimmage by backup defensive end KJ Smith, number 56, a sophomore from Frisco, Texas. A versatile kid that can play a number of different spots in that alignment of defensive coordinator Phil Bennett.
Just outside the Dallas area, he shows you 255. He can still get down and close and collapse at the end position.
Second down, 11. Darius Crowley, the wide receiver, goes flanked to the top of your screen. A trip set. Looking for incomplete. Pass was intended for Barbell, 82. Third down and 11 coming up.
As Trayvon Blanchard had a shot at it to come underneath that ball. And again, he's gambling a bit, but you can do it with the kind of lead that they have and man coverage. And
that's what they do. That's the foundation of what Phil Bennett's defense is. He makes no bones about the fact that they will gamble.
But I think he kind of resisted the notion of people thinking that, as we look at him, that is a gamble. It's really the DNA of what good defense is anymore. You take calculated risk and allow guys to play man coverage.
For Crowley, incomplete. Pass may have been a little bit underthrown. But the coverage was there. Ryan Reed, number nine, step for step with Darius Crowley.
And here's an example of it. To the wide side of the field, you know, you think going to take a shot at Reed. He's got a little soft coverage. He's turning and running. He will take a look at that ball. He doesn't. That's great. That's tremendous defense. Most young corners don't have the aptitude or the ability to turn and locate. But again, Reed shows you exactly how you play to the wide side of the field. You've got the space. Use every bit of it.
So the drive stalls, and they'll punt it away. Lynx Hawthorne is back deep. Fair catch called at the 10-yard line, just outside the 10, at the 11. Just a 26-yard boot, but they do manage to get the ball inside the 20-yard line. Outstanding D from a program note. Gus and Joel Klatt and Molly McGrath for our feature matchup, Kansas State and TCU. Jared Steven in the game at quarterback, and Johnny Jefferson carries it ahead to the 23-yard line. Jarrett's a freshman, Stephenville, Texas. Best young quarterback that Kendall Briles has ever seen.
A little bit smaller, 6'3", 195, but he's got an arm and he's got some athleticism, too. He can pull it down the run when he has to.
Yeah. They just recycle them, don't they? I mean, it's one after the other after the other, and the book is in on Seth. We mentioned at halftime, 18 of 27. He did run one in as well, so a great day for him. And Colt Coleman there was his go-to guy early, three touchdowns for him.
Yeah, and Art knows a thing or two about Stephenville, having coached there in the high school level and done a tremendous job. He's a legend in Texas high school football.
Little swing pattern out to Jefferson, undercut. Good defensive reaction there from Tyrone Miller Jr., freshman from Ann Arbor, Michigan, another guy that they think so highly of. Hard-working dream kid to coach, says Clint Bowen, the defensive coordinator for the Jayhawks.
And that's the kind of character that Clint told us he wants to recruit. He's got to go for guys with character, because this is a place right now where the challenge is going to be tough, Tim.
Second and 12. Nice. Boy, what a pass. That's a dart thrown to Platt. The redshirt freshman from Willits, Texas, gathers it in.
Love how Platt just took advantage of that zone coverage and trying to go up-tempo here and get as much experience in terms of the overall scheme as the starters.
14 yards the game.
Nice.
And Terrence Williams pops it. Look, his number is 9.4 yards per carry coming into this game, second in the nation. So, okay, fine. We'll get rid of Shaq Linwood, and then we'll go with a guy that averages just under 10 a carry. Well, when he comes in.
Since Linwood has certainly softened them up a little bit, but Double Deuce can run the ball as well.
Oh, flanker screen.
Yeah, a jailbreak screen there. That's nice.
Ishmael Zamora on the receiving end. He's also been outstanding in special teams with kick returns. Zamora. Tyrone Miller Jr. again making the stop. Second down and three. Steedham's pass thrown a little behind but caught by Platt, and that's a first down.
That's just a well-designed play, a little switch route off of into the short side of the field, three receivers, and but such a wicked and nasty formation to try to defend, because one of those guys is going to end up being a picker. You got to decide if you're off coverage which guy you're going to defend. So tough.
So from overhead, Ishmael Zamora gets free quite easily.
Jared says, do you want Zamora? He says, yeah, here's some. And he throws a strike versus man coverage. Zamora just plucks that out. Single safety look. Too far for him to cover that water, Timmy. Another strike for the Baylor Bears.
I mean, it does not look dissimilar at all from the first unit, does it?
It does not. Again, from scheme, that's exactly what our brows and Kendall says they want to do. They cannot pull off because, again, they're looking down the road. They're anticipating not being in a situation similar to they were last year.
I mean, they're going to be involved in a lot of games where the first 1 to 50 wins. This is the sixth Baylor receiver with a catch of at least 18-plus yards. Russell's on the sidelines, and he's like, oh, yeah, that's a President's Club clap there.
Hey, how you doing? I'm Larry Culpepper, member of the College Football Playoff. I know you are.
It's an eternity, and one of the things R said, look, if we can reduce the time and it takes us to score. We're going to try to find a way to improve that. And so it's really kind of an Edwards-Demings approach to this whole deal, never-ending improvement. Whatever the standard is, he has to stay one. He feels he has to stay one step ahead with respect to innovation, and he's done that in spades.
That healthy breeze, it goes through the end zone again for a touchback. And by the way, just in case you were wondering, in 2013, Baylor beat Iowa State 71-7. They also put 73 on West Virginia in a 73-42 win. And, you know, you start thinking about what is it. At least, listen, he's got all of his backups playing from an offensive standpoint, but he's not going to slow down. This is the way they play. And you can't blame them. You know, this is a weekly beauty pageant, college football today. Anything less and you get knocked down a peg or two. Gary Patterson did a year ago when they were challenged on senior day here, and Kansas took them into the final quarter with the game very much in doubt. Willis trying to get away from some pressure and now loops it long, and it's caught. A one-handed grab. Kent Taylor. Beautiful catch. The Velcro Man, number 81.
Now there's some laundry on the ground, but levels, despite the pressure.
And a shoe.
Yeah.
Laundry and your tutu and your shoe, right?
Oh, my God.
Oh, you got a flag down, too. Well, that's kind of in keeping with the...
Replay, first down.
So they'll bring it back. Unfortunately for Kansas, that was a wonderful catch that will be negated. 40-yard gain taken away by...
It's worth seeing because there's a lot that was going on. The pressure and then the delivery of this pass. It kept, man, just a one-handed catch in space. Beautiful job by Taylor on that one.
Pass is incomplete, intended for Jeremiah Booker. Offensive interference brought it back, but boy, it was a beautiful pass.
Yeah, I think that
and
was,
catch.
It was. It really was. And I'll tell you, I've got to go back to how this Baylor, that last play was standing, the previous one. They're playing a tremendous job on the defense on the back end.
Second and 23. Willis goes underneath to the 15-yard line. The catch is made by Cox. Really unfortunate to think that this offense, already crippled with some injuries this week, lost its leading receiver, Trey Parmalee, one of its top go-to guys, Bobby Hartsock, and Keon Kenner, whom we really felt coming in would be. There's Bobby. He's got that patella problem.
Yeah, but Parmalee's loss was really big. I mean, Hartsock's was as well, but he was the guy they were expecting to really be able to usher in this kind of up-tempo, you know, how mummy connected type of air raid attack, and you just don't have him out there, and he knows the system as well. That's a tough loss.
And without Keon Kenner,
yeah.
Cox has done the best that he can, but he's their most dynamic player. He's stopped there by Pat Levels, number 21, the junior from Roosevelt High in Dallas, making the stop. Back up nickelbacker to Trayvon Blanchard.
Yeah, Kenner had an outstanding opener and then had over 100 yards back-to-back games and then kind of went silent, because you expect that in the course of the year teams respond to what you do well. Another flag here, Tim.
Yep. Didn't have a fair catch called for, but the ball rolls out of bounds and a marker is down as well, so we'll check on that after just a 37-yard boot.
Don't be surprised if these coaches still coach these guys hard, because you tend to see an inordinate amount of penalties in situations like this where you've got a huge lead. But if you're trying to build character and depth in your team on both sides of the ball, you've got to make sure that they understand to play the game for 60 minutes. So whether it's Art Briles, he's motivating and encouraging these guys. You can see it there. And on defense, Bennett will do the same thing.
There are two fouls, illegal formation, kicking team, more than four men in the backfield. That penalty is declined. Kick catching interference, kicking team. 15-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
Yep, that did occur after a fair catch had been called. So another short field for the Bears to work with when they get it. They got a brand new stadium in Waco. Bright and shiny.
334-1197. That's 800-334-1197.
59-7 with six and change remaining here in the third quarter. Tim Brando, Spencer Tillman, happy to have you with us. First of three games on the Fox Family of Networks on this college football Saturday. Wow. Stevens pass to a wide open receiver. It's Davion Hall for a touchdown. 30 yards.
Tyrell Miller was covering there. Again, you had him isolated to the wide side of the field. And Stidman just found him there. And it's all about winning individual battles. And Kansas lost one on that play.
Well, Steedham looks really good.
Yeah, Steedham is,
he is throwing darts out there. Everything that we heard about him is true.
Well, he's been able to discern what they're doing, and he's actually shared some time, and every time they've had an opportunity to get him in the game with comfortable leads, they've done it.
Yeah. When you're that open, you're going to get a lot of scoring opportunities, and he was.
Nothing artificial. Just real roasted turkey. Salt, pepper, carved thick. That's the right way to make a good turkey sandwich. The right way to eat it is however you eat it. Panera. Food as it should be.
66-7 our score after that quick strike from Steedham to the wide open receiver Davion Hall, sophomore from Texarkana, Texas. I mean, their receiving core, it's like a bus stop. You know, they keep bringing in new guys. They just keep loading it up.
It's the system, man. The system has a lot to do with it. It's getting the ball in the hands of tremendous athletes.
We're going to take a look again at just how
and
open
it happened.
He got.
Yeah, it happened against like a cover two look, and we use that term cover two because of the two deep safeties, and you're just going to find an opportunity against that cover two with the shallow crossing route underneath it that holds the safety down low that opens up the post route, and that's just a well-designed play and a better athlete beating another athlete. That's a tremendous job by Baylor.
The question becomes, and this happens a lot with spread teams, Spencer, and we'll have obviously plenty of time to get through many global pieces of conversation in college football before this one is over. Taylor Cox is in the game, and he'll take it off the left-hand side. Let's quickly get back to our Los Angeles studios and a game break from Jenny Taft.
Well, Tim, the number one team in the country tied at 21 with Maryland in the third quarter until this. Cardale Jones finds Jalen Marshall 48 yards for the touchdown. This one has been back and forth. The Buckeyes back on top, 28-21. Tim, I'll keep you posted with the latest.
Whoa, thank you, Jenny. Feel free to hop in anytime. We welcome any interruption that you have back in Los Angeles. Taylor Cox is in the backfield again on second down and 8. And Cox, good strong run beyond the 30 to the 31-yard line. The question becomes, Spencer, for teams like Baylor that beat you with formation, what about when you go against a physical enough team that can man you up and they have quality cover corners that can be difference makers?
Well, I will cede you this. You can find more cover guys than you can guys, let's say, on the defensive side at the end position to play this game in the spread era that we're in. But I guarantee you this. The numbers game will catch up with you eventually. There is no way. You just cannot cover the entire breadth and width of the field against these spread concepts.
Out pattern to Patrick. It's on the deck, incomplete at the 35-yard line.
And, Tim, what complicates is it's oftentimes when you get a quarterback that can run the ball well.
They are going to say he caught the ball. I thought that the ball popped free, but
yep,
they are saying that he did catch the football.
And the dynamic that we have not seen is moving the quarterback and running with him more. When that happens, then you're down an extra man because you have to assign someone to defend that quarterback should he pull it down and run in this system. And you still are creating one-on-one matchups, and I believe that Baylor or any school has enough weapons to beat you in this spread era that we're in.
And gets it out to the 38-yard line on the first down carry. The reason I mention that is, but even with Baylor's success, and they've had so much of it, okay, when they've gone into bowl season play, even with the three consecutive 11-plus win seasons, right, for them, they have not gotten the job done in their bowl game opportunities.
Michigan State, I understand. Those two games that they lost last year stuck in their craw big time. There's no question about it. That's the reason why they focus so much on defense. And occasionally they will get gashed, but Timmy, that's usually when they've got a three-man front and you're in a down and distance situation where they just guess, and it happens from time to time. But I'll take this defensive front, and I'll put them in the category of the best in America as far as the unit.
Second and seven, a pass caught by Derek Neal. Squirmed free from one would-be tackler and got it to the 40-yard line. Levels got him down on the ground.
Tim, your points are well taken, and it's a result of you understanding the game, and most people don't see it that way. So I have to harken back to the idea of becoming comfortable with what constitutes better defense these days. Giving up yardage is not the death knell that it used to be. And when you look and see a guy is giving up 300 yards or more offense, that's not necessarily a bad day.
No, you're right.
Big 12.
Listen, I think Alabama's still known for defense, aren't they?
Oh, yeah.
Well,
yeah.
How many times has Nick Saban given up over 40 points this year?
Well, I can tell you.
It's happened.
It's happened. Absolutely.
Yeah. Willis throwing, and it's caught. Well, that's a nice grab by Jeremiah Booker. He's been very effective today, and they've needed him with the loss of Parmalee and Hartsock. That's a good pass and catch.
Yeah, it is under pressure, just a little bit coming back. You can see how many white jerseys are back there defending, but that's an excellent job of pitching and catching by Kansas.
First and 10 with the ball at the 45. That ball was batted in the air. I think the oncoming linebacker, Pat Levels, got through there with pressure and knocked that one down.
Yeah, that's a lost art, particularly at this level, where you can time it up. If you know you're not going to get to the quarterback, one way you can affect them is to disrupt the pattern and the flight of the ball, but you got to time it, and Levels did on that last play.
Second and 10.
The Levels playing inside. He's a pressure guy. I love the matchup against a tackle who's bigger. You got a safety behind him. That screams coming pressure off the edge.
Here it comes. And there he goes. It affected the pass. And it's incomplete. Should have been caught. Emmanuel Moore had it in his grasp. Willis, knowing the heat was coming, still had some mustard on that pass. That was a good one.
And he can do something and actually move that play. I love the out route, the will, the up and out. Out and up, a tremendous job of getting there, but the pressure on the backside is what really forced that a little bit earlier than they needed to.
Should have been caught.
Yep.
Third and 10.
Same alignment, inside slot guy working on the tackle.
More pressure. And a back shoulder throw and a comeback here that time to Jeremiah Booker. I think he got the first down. He did. You're playing against a team like Baylor. You got to make these kinds of catches.
That's right. Again, this is basic football. You know, it's a tough one. You had to turn your body. But if it touches your hands and it's within that strike zone, you got to catch that ball. It's tough.
Did I hear you say strike zone? You have been watching some baseball.
I have. It's in my mind, man. It's
between you and Mike Helling, our producer, the Astros Royals, blood. It's a bloodbath between you two. There goes Mann trying to bounce it out towards the wide side of the field, and he's dragged down behind the line of scrimmage.
The man had a notion for more. Nice job of stiff-arming Levels and company, but got strung out to the wide side of the field. That shows you some of the speed. The ability to run and chase for Phil Bennett's back end.
Look at that. Now he's limping off. Raquan Davis got him down. It's becoming a mash unit here in Lawrence. Taylor Cox back into the game on second and 12.
See if he takes a shot off the numbers here with the reduction by the wideout.
Yep. Looking long for Patrick. Tried to make the adjustment in midair. The defender did not see the ball, but Patrick could not catch up to it.
That was a great decision, though. Again, what you're looking at is a reduction to the wide side of the field when he cut down his splits. And then your quarterback, Willis, is looking for an opportunity to exploit that. That was a wise call upstairs. And, of course, eliminating the middleman here in Kansas and communicating that directly to Ryan Wills. Willis.
Rob Likens, the offensive coordinator, really interesting story on how he wound up here in Lawrence, working with David Beatty, the head coach. Third down and 12 coming up. Interesting call to run it here, only ahead for a couple. Obviously, you're thinking four downs. At least I think you would be thinking four downs, no, but maybe absolutely. Not. They're gonna. It looks like they're going to punt it away.
Yeah, that's interesting.
I would have thought with that kind of play call, you're thinking about going for it on fourth down on this side of the field. But the head coach decides to boot it away. Lynx Hawthorne will drop back deep. He'll be at the 10-yard line.
I guess it's a matter of how ugly does 73 look besides 66.
Listen, you're trying to keep your guys healthy, too. I think, they just don't have enough bullets offensively right now. The sooner this one ends, the better for the health of his program. That's got to be entering into the mindset. 43-yard boot into the end zone. Well, what is ahead for the Baylor Bears, you ask?
Well, you got 4 weeks of relatively mild situation where they'll be favored. And depending on what happens with this Oklahoma matchup, that November 14th, that could be that date that was already circled. But the Longhorns, Charlie Strong's group, showing a little signs of life.
Yeah, they are today. But, don't sleep on Oklahoma State either. That's a tough one in Stillwater, no doubt. But, I'll say this, the Pac-12 is cannibalizing, the SEC is cannibalizing. The one conference that I think home field seemingly matters and the teams that we thought were good are and maybe even better than we thought are in the Big 12.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Pass is caught. It's Chris Platt. And that should end the third quarter of play. Shy of the first down.
I'm just asking, curious, if you had Week 5 circled with Cal and Utah as the matchup. No. That's just the landscape. That's where we are.
But Jared Goff is one of the best quarterbacks in the country. He'll have to be that tonight when they play. 66-7, our score here in Lawrence, Kansas. We've weeks into the season. The Baylor Bears are as advertised, and the meat of their schedule may still be in front of them. They're leading right now. We welcome you back. And the quick handoff out to the 35-yard line is to Johnny Jefferson. Tim Brando, Spencer Tillman will be joined by Mike Pereira back in our studios a little later on. We'll talk about some of the nuances with a game of blowout proportion with our keeper of the rule book. A little bit later on here in this quarter, Johnny Jefferson gets it out to the 45-yard line. We'll mark it to the 42-yard line, I beg your pardon. And second and a yard to go. Well, Jefferson was pretty lucky to hang on to the ball there on that previous play.
Everybody's going up tempo again. He lost the end of it, didn't he? That's the reason why they talk about 3 points of pressure, the tip of the ball up against your rib and then on the outside. And if you do that, carrying it high and tight. If you remember years ago, Tiki Barber started doing that where it was obvious with the Giants. And every college kid was emulating that. Got to get back to it.
Ooh, almost found another big tight end. They found a new big one. Cody George this time, all 6'1", 250 of him.
Yeah, Cody almost had this one again. It's a beautiful toss and throw through that window with pressure.
Oh, excuse Valdez. Me. That's Valdez. Not Cody George. That was Valdez who was on the receiving end, or the intended receiver in that sequence. Terrence Williams inside the 45 to the 43-yard line in the arms of Chevy Graham, number 36.
Chevy Graham came in high on that one, and Williams took him for a little bit of a ride, a couple of extra. But one of the three running backs on this Baylor team that are in the top 10 in the conference just shows you how prolific they are.
Terrence Williams gets it down to the 35-yard line. That's a first down. Graham again makes the tackle.
Well, Graham is probably going to get tired of coming high on Williams because he's taking him for a couple of extra yards on successive plays.
Jared Steedham has been in for the entire second half, and he has looked sharp. He had come into this game 13 of 16 in the air. He had gotten some quality playing time before today, but this is the most that he's gotten to call signals. Chris Platt has that one.
You know, when you talk about the three C's, two of them that Steedham really shows command and certainly the clarity of communicating what comes from the sideline. He's really a smart-looking kid.
Kansas needed a timeout that time. They were fatigued and not lined up. Mike Pereira will join us when we come back. Stay tuned.
Oh, man.
Rules Guru is going to join us. Can you do a little song and dance for us, Mike? It's good to have you. Hey, give us some thoughts on how the officials handle games of this caliber, both with replay and just in terms of governance when a game is as lopsided as the one we've got right now.
Well, I got to tell you, when games used to get like this, when I was on the field, I was thinking about where we were going to go to dinner after the game was over. But you do say, hey, let's bury the flags in the pocket and let's only call player safety issues or snap infraction things that are so obvious. You literally do want to get the game over. And replay, you know, says that they're not going to stop the play and they shouldn't stop a play unless there's a direct competitive impact in the game, and I would say that there's not a direct anything that would have a direct competitive impact. Lastly, and we were talking off air a little bit, you know, what can you do to shorten the game? And it used to be, Tim, you remember, you could play with a running clock.
Right.
They don't allow you to do that anymore, but by agreement of the two head coaches and the referee, either at halftime or during the break before the fourth quarter, they could agree to shorten the period, which they didn't do, but that is one option to, you know, to shorten a game like this.
Yeah, well, we were just discussing a moment ago. Here's a penalty.
Number 77, offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Patrick Lawrence is penalized there. We were discussing why you know, Coach Beatty decided to punt the ball away, Spencer and I. Basically, I came to the determination they've got so many guys hurt that he's just trying to get to next week, you know. And I think in some cases the idea of moving the game along is about self-preservation, too. Jefferson. Ben Goodman made the stop.
I mean, that is so true when they talk about it. And that's what we felt on the field, too. You know, in games like this, you didn't want to see people get hurt. And you also understand backups wanted time to play. But, you know, really, you really do want to move the game on.
Second down and 17. We're visiting with Mike Pereira back in our That pass is caught. Little quick look into Chris Johnson at the 18-yard line. He stopped.
Chris Johnson.
Have you noticed, Mike, that the replay this year, from the standpoint of what is constituting, you know, a distinguishable change, is not being enforced to the extent maybe in the college game that it was a season ago?
I don't know. You know, I think they've thrown in an element here which strikes me has been a little bit difficult for replay is this whole targeting issue and how they are now able to take away the targeting and the penalty. And when we watched a targeting hit in the USC game against Washington the other night, and then another one today that we watched, they look so similar. One was reversed and the other one was confirmed. I think they're having a little bit of issue with that, and that's had an effect on replay.
Well, Mike, we really do appreciate it. Great having a chance to chat with you. And tell Jenny if she's got any updates for us, we'll take those too as the afternoon progresses here. That field goal is no good, but it was. College football on FS1 is presented by Geico. 66-7 our score with 10:45 remaining. Tim Brando, Spencer Tillman, happy to have you with us. As we continue, Seth Russell and his backup, who's played very well, Jared Steinem, By the way, our apologies to the Stoddard family. We did ask before when we were in our conversations, because we certainly thought the backup quarterback would have a chance to play in this game, and we were under the impression the name was Steedham. Our apologies to their family for the mispronunciation. Taylor Martin takes it out to the 25-yard line.
Tim, it does nothing to take away from the success he's contributed here. Again,
indeed.
You know, Baylor last year reached 600 yards of offense in five games in 2014. And here they've done it four times already this year. And we're close to it right now, if not already trumping that.
Old saying in our business, by the way, mamas and daddies like their names pronounced in our industry.
Say it right.
Yes,
say
indeed. My name. And if you got it wrong, fix it. Second and six. Quick out to Darius Crowley. He's got it. Clock continues to run. Let's go to Jenny Taft for a quick update in Los Angeles. Jenny.
Get up quickly. Well, Timmy asked for more updates, so here's the latest from the Red River rivalry. Samaje Perine with the one-yard touchdown. Number 10, Oklahoma, now within seven. It's 24-17 in the fourth quarter. Tim Spencer, back to you.
Wow. Very important for Oklahoma, and really in a large measure, the Big 12 Conference, when you think about it, and we'll get into the specifics of that in just a moment.
Go.
Here's Martin again. And he's got a first down from the 30 to 31. The reason I say this is because both Baylor and TCU need Oklahoma to be as relevant
Absolutely.
As they can possibly be when measuring up with the College Football Playoff Committee.
That aspect under this playoff structure is still, in my opinion, as important as it was in the old structure, because if those 12 or 13 people are doing their jobs right, they're going to look exactly who you beat. And it's going to matter how strong you are. So the Big 12 as a conference also has to understand anything they can do to inoculate themselves from the round robin format that they have. So there's no question, or at least little question in the end, they need to do that.
Levels makes the tackle of Martin at the 35-yard line. Well, listen, Oklahoma State's really good. They're undefeated, but the bulk of their, or the meat of their schedule is still in front of them. Sooners, as we know, offensively can really turn it on with what they're trying to do, and Lincoln Riley calling the shots with their offense. But more than anything else, without a championship game at the end, TCU and Baylor need to be tested by as many top-caliber opponents as possible.
Go.
Martin again, out to the 39-yard line, a couple of yards shy of a first down.
And to follow up on that point, again, despite the fact that you have this lopsided score here, listen, Baylor is cognizant of what you just said, Timmy, and so they're going to have their guys running their offensive system deep into this game, because that's what they do. They're not going to dial back. And you know, when you got last year with TCU and Baylor both being eclipsed by Ohio State.
I think we've got an injury timeout. Getting, the officials called the timeout to get Vaughns off the field. The redshirt freshman was nicked up on that play. So that's why we had the momentary pause.
Yeah, Vaughn's been playing physical ball, and he kind of reminds me, when wearing that number 27, of Thomas Everett years ago, the former Thorpe Award winner.
Well, you are going back. I like that.
Yeah.
Very nice.
I can start to go back on you with our
Bobby
with
Jack
Jenny.
Goforth was playing with him, wasn't he, at Baylor? I believe Bobby Jack Goforth was playing.
Grant Taft was the head coach then at that time. But
maybe one of the greatest names for a highlight
Goforth,
ever.
Tremendous.
Goforth, young man in Concord. Yep. Taylor Martin stopped behind the line of scrimmage this time. So if we're going to go back, then why not go back to this guy? Huh? Big Mike Singletary in the day.
Boy, his eyes were like saucers back there in that middle linebacker position. He'd be staring at you, man, and he'd put it in your watch pocket every time he delivered it. Grant Taft had a great one in him. Of course, went on all those great years he had with Chicago, and then he's just a tremendous head coach and had a run there at San Francisco as well, and he's a good one.
Lynx Hawthorne takes that boot and is stopped in his tracks immediately, shy of the 15-yard line. 45-yard boot as we empty our bucket here in Lawrence, Kansas.
One, two, three, four.
Life is about knowing what you live for.
Enjoy. Last week from the back end of the 10, of course, 13-member committee that we have. Spencer and I are part of that. Our Jeff Long and commissioner of our council is Stuart Mandel. And we put together our top 10 teams, and then the collaboration comes up with a four teams at the top that we list each and every week.
I'm going to put you on the spot, partner, here. Have we adjudicated this fairly with Ohio State sitting there at that number one spot?
I don't think so. No.
I'm just saying, man.
I would disagree with Ohio State being number two. I would.
Yeah.
Terrence Williams ahead to the 22-23-yard line. Again, so much of it based on the so-called eye test. Well, I mean, if you're going to say that, which I think is overused, truth of the matter is, up until the time Michigan State laid the egg against Purdue, they had a better eye test than Ohio State this year. I had to drop Michigan State after that performance a week ago. I think there are other teams that are more deserving than Ohio State of being in the number two position.
Well, I don't think anything happens in a vacuum. Last year, I had Ohio State jumping because of issues off the field as much as what was happening on the field. They had the death of a player.
Oh, yeah.
You had them dominating Wisconsin, the next closest competitor. And so I thought the combination of that, having gone through their third quarterback, and then Cordell Jones, essentially no experience whatsoever, leads them down the stretch of that lopsided win over Wisconsin. In my mind, I thought they deserved to be in that position again. But this year, it's a different story, Tim. They're not that same juggernaut of a team. So it's a little bit of entitlement, but you know, the tradition is the currency of college football. And if not in an obvious, a subconscious way, I think we give him a mulligan.
The underused Drew Galitz is in to punt it away. The freshman from Rowlett High School, Rowlett, Texas. Derek Neal is back deep awaiting the punt. Number seven for Kansas.
Low liner.
Yeah. Returnable for Neal. What a great shoestring tackle made there. Alfred Pullum down there to make the grab. The number three team in our Fox 4 poll, doing just fine, thank you. 4:52 remaining here in Lawrence.
This Sunday, the Seattle Seahawks head to Cincinnati to take on the Bengals. The Red Rifle takes aim at the NFC champs at home in the jungle.
66-7 our score. As you look from high overhead, courtesy of our DirecTV blimp. Tim Brando, Spencer Tillman, Taylor Martin remains in the game with the true freshman quarterback Ryan Willis. His first ever start, quite an indoctrination. One good thing for this Kansas team. They're going to, as they say, trial by fire and get better as time goes on. Well, one of a kind play of the game. Pretty easy one to select, don't you think?
Yeah, LeBron McGowan, the big guy, showing you some athleticism as he spills into the end zone. Oh, man, he's a load.
You know, the other tight end, 15, Gus Penning is an outstanding tight end. I mean, he's overshadowed, but then again, that is a big, long shadow cast when you've got 6'7", 410-pounder on the depth chart ahead of you.
Yeah, Big Daddy's a rock star. I was watching some of the B-roll of him in pregame last week, and somebody ran into him incidentally, you know, contact, and he thought better of it because he didn't have any other teammates to come save him. Big boy kind of shoved him to the side like he was a little fly. He's a gifted, talented guy. You don't see very many 410-pounders who can move like he can.
And as we mentioned, their strength and conditioning people will tell you, you can get in better shape, and I'm guessing he'll work to do that over time as Martin carries it to the 48-yard line. But his body fat is only 30%. Which is about what every offensive lineman's body fat would be. Mm-hmm. So he's really no difference other than that he's 6'7". And at that size, 410 would be that 30% that we're discussing.
And you can tell why he's such an asset. I mean, again, it's physics. You know, speed plus mass equals force. And when you got a guy that big, 410 pounds from Amarillo, Texas, I'm sure he spent a lot of time in Lake Meredith there fishing and probably eating of that fish before it got back to the house. He's a big boy, man.
Chandler stopped by Raquan Davis, number 19. And he's talking to his quarterback, too. He's learning
the
game quickly, yeah.
No, he's lobbing for
plays. I'm always there. I'm a quality option.
I'm open. Yeah, he does have his own zip code. He's a big dude, man. You can't get close to this guy. He is great hands, can move.
Sharp cat, too.
Fourth down and a yard to go, a little over a yard, yard and a half or so. Looks like they're going to take a timeout. They are. After utilizing as much of the play clock as they could. We'll continue right after this. His dad has got to be very proud today. His youngster getting an opportunity to start his first ever collegiate game. His father, Steve, was a place kicker at Kansas State between 1981 and 84. Hit 76 of 78 extra points and 64% on field goals. As on fourth down, they hand it to Taylor Martin, and he's stopped by Raekwon Davis. Looks like the Bears may have stopped them shy of the first down and take over on downs.
And who knows if he's the solution for this offense, but they have gone through, as Kansas, Michael Cummings, if you remember, they lost him back way back in the spring, and then Montel Cozart, the left shoulder that knocked him out, and then DeAndre Ford also, he had the surgery on his thumb, the ligament. So he's here. You have Willis. He's the fourth option here. So,
and we asked the question too of Coach Beatty: is he your future? He says, "Well, he could be. He would not. He would not go all the way of saying, yeah, he is. But from a drop back passing standpoint, he was highly recruited. A lot of schools wanted him. But in this offense, mobility does matter.
It does matter, because as you can see, they like to move the pocket a lot, so you've got to be able to do that and still get squared up and deliver a strike, particularly against more athletic back ends like you're going to see in this conference.
There's Terrence Williams carrying it to the 45. Well, we have a Stidham update. It's actually Stidham.
Stidham.
That's what I'm being told.
Short out.
Yeah, well, we're doing our best to get it right.
It's a process.
Yes, it is. I'm very impressed with his play, I'll tell you that, regardless of the exact pronunciation. Terrence Williams carries it to the 40-yard line. He's got a rifle arm, and it's clear that he's going to be in beautiful shape. No one will have a problem with his name as soon as he takes over for Seth Russell. I can guarantee you that. Not in this offense, because Art and Kendall Briles know how to get it done, no matter who the quarterback may be.
Well, all you need to know for the insiders out there to understand high school football in the state of Texas, when you say Stephenville, the DNA of Stephenville, the spread formation, it has its roots in that area. And, of course, Art Briles, having coached there at high school level where he is, and I'm not, this is not hyperbole, he's a god there.
Yep. Terrence Williams has it to the 25-yard line. And people talk about Charlie Strong's issues, and maybe he's working on that imagery today in the Red River rivalry. The reason why it's going so poorly for him right now is the landscape is not the same in the state of Texas as it was when Daryl Royal got there, when John McAvick got there, and even further when Mac Brown got there. I mean, not only are you dealing with Briles at Baylor, but A&M's got a rock star coach and a new affiliation with a power conference. Texas Tech is slinging that baby around. Cliff Kingsbury may be Art Briles' light. I mean, it's just a new world out there in college football. Chad Morris is making a difference now at SMU.
Absolutely.
Williams again carries inside the 25 to the 24.
Back in the day, that used to be the ambient heat from some of those programs that you're talking about. But right now, it's white-hot pressure that Kevin Sumlin on the recruiting trail is putting on everybody. Coach Patterson with those tandem of offensive coordinators has there. Doug Meacham, Sonny Cumbie.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because I left TCU out.
Yeah, oh,
the whole story,
are you kidding me?
They went from flying the ointment to big boy ball in a heartbeat.
It did. And it put pressure on everyone, man. And I'll tell you, the margin of error has shrunk to nothing, essentially, on the recruiting trail. So that's direct heat now.
Well, this is nice to see. They take a knee in victory formation. Call it a day. Art Briles showing a great deal of respect, understandably so, for David Beatty, a guy that values and really looks up to Coach Briles. They're good friends. And you know, you could have made a case that they could have hung 80 or more points. And the process continues for Coach Beatty and for Art Briles. Yet another victory. And they remain undefeated and likely to at least stand pat, if not move up. We could have some movement ahead of them in the college football polls between now and the end of this day. Well, Spencer, enjoyed it. I'll see you again next week, my friend.
All right, my friend.
66-7, our final. Oh, after this short break, we'll get you back to Los Angeles for a lot more college football coverage. Kevin Burkhardt of the game. Stay tuned.